Hi, good afternoon. So good seeing all of you here. I know it's day two. It's late in the afternoon, but it's great to have all of you here. As we're talking about accelerating impact with AI-powered low-code tools, my name is Ted. I'm a PM lead on the AI team, and I have the privilege of working with our product team partners to deliver AI capabilities into Copilot.
Thanks, and my name is Ben Walters. I'm a product manager on the Power Platform team, and I know we all stand between you and celebratory beer, so we will do our best to make this as fun and as exciting as possible.
Yeah, and so today we'll start talking about why low-code. So we talk about Power Platform, and why Copilot? I'm sure you've probably heard Copilot said enough times today. Make a great drinking game tonight every time somebody says Copilot. But we'll spend most of our time going through demos and then talking about demystifying the AI behind the scenes of what's going on with Copilot. And then we'll talk a little bit about what's next. And so that's all that we're going to be focusing on. So as we talk about low code, right, why low code? IDC did a study, and they were looking at a shortfall of about 500 million apps. So you think about the next few years and how many apps will need to be built in the enterprise. And this is not necessarily the apps that you know, you'll be building for your end users, but think of your frontline workers, your sales folks, your customer service agents. These are the apps that are needed. And there's a shortfall of developers to build those apps, about 4 million developers. And that's really where Power Platform comes in. And from a low-code perspective, we're also at the midpoint of the low-code revolution. Think about in 2020, about 25% of apps were built with low-code tools. In 2026, the estimate is about 75% of apps will be built with low-code tools. And that's really where Power Platform comes in to bridge that gap. And as we think about what employees want from AI, it's really about finding answers, doing analytics. Pretty much any business process can be accelerated and improved with AI. So this is what we're hearing from employees of the things that could be improved with AI. Now, what do leaders want from AI? And the cool thing is, leaders want employees to be empowered with AI. Some of the most, some of the biggest things that we hear or the biggest concerns, people might be afraid of saying, huh, is AI going to take my job? But the great thing here is employees and leaders are on the same page, empowering people to do more. Because when it's about reducing headcount, it's at the end. It's at the bottom of the barrel here. It's really about empowering people to do more. So with our low-code platform, Power Platform, Power BI for analytics, Power Apps for building, editing, beautiful apps. Power Automate to automate all the flows and mundane tasks so you could do all the high-value work. Power Pages, building web pages. And also Microsoft Copilot Studio that you've been hearing a lot about with all the other components of our low-code platform. This is what's going to bridge that gap to get you to those 500 million apps to cover that 4 million developer shortfall. And low-code has a copilot that can help generate content, that can spark creativity, automate cognitive tasks, and create user experiences. And that's really the beauty of Copilot coming alongside makers in this low-code revolution. So let's take a little bit of a backstage look at demystifying all of the AI underneath the covers. You've probably seen a lot of stuff online of large language models and what they can do. But what are these large language models in the first place? And why can they do what they can? And more importantly, what they may not be able to do? So the first part of it is, what kind of models are there? And our partnership with OpenAI, it gives us access to these models. And one of the first class of models would be the GPT or ChatGPT models, right? So how many of you ever had a conversation with ChatGPT? Yeah, so quite a few of you, right? And so you've probably seen these online where somebody would ask, how would you remove a peanut butter sandwich from a VCR in the style of the King James Bible? Right, and ChatGPT would say things like, fear not, for thou canst remove a peanut butter sandwich with a pair of tweezers or pliers, right? And ChatGPT can walk you through every single step in removing that peanut butter sandwich from the VCR. Codex is a fine-tuned version of GPT, and this is fine-tuned to generate code. So here you can give a prompt, You can give an instruction, and Codex will give you code. And this is what GitHub Copilot X is based on, the fine-tuned version of GPT that generates code. DALL-E generates images. So you can give it a prompt, and then it'll generate an image, as you can see here, a centered explosion of colorful powder on a black background. So a beautiful image that comes out of a DALL-E model. So these are the three different families of models that are available, and that's what we use as we build out the Copilot capabilities in Power Platform. So how are these models trained? The way I like to think about training these models is essentially playing a massive fill-in-the-blanks game with the internet. So imagine you take a sentence from a Wikipedia or from some public source, and you blank out some words, something like the cook puts blank in the birthday blank. So in training the GPT model, you would ask GPT, hey, what would you fill in these blanks with? And GPT might take a guess and say, the cook puts salt in a birthday pizza. And you would say, oh, no, that's not what it should be. It should be the cook puts sugar in a birthday cake. And GPT would say, oh, okay, that's what it should be, update its parameters, and then you play the game again with another sentence from the internet. Blank out some words, ask it to guess, and then correct it when it's wrong, and then you do it with the next sentence, and the next sentence, and the next sentence. And when you do this with pretty much every single sentence from the internet, you get a model that could do some pretty amazing things. But we do have to remember, at the end of the day, it is a statistical model. It's trying to predict the next word that comes in a sequence of words. And then it'll take that sequence and then predict the next word after that. And that's essentially what's happening underneath the covers. So this is how these large language models are trained. Now, one of the biggest questions that we get are, what happens when I send data to this model? What if I asked a GPT model, summarize my top 5 trade secrets, or here are my 5 secret strategies for my next year? What's happening underneath the covers? Well, the model itself never changes. The model does not get smarter. If you go ask GPT, if your competitor goes ask GPT, it will not say, oh, I just learned these secrets from your competitor, and let me tell you now. From a data science perspective, it's pure inference only. And the way that I'll illustrate this is with building a model to predict the Microsoft closing stock price. And so being a Microsoft employee, we care about Microsoft closing stock prices. So imagine I have data for the first 6 months of 2023. And when I train a model, I'm essentially fitting some algorithm, some equation to this data. And training, I'm going to use a very, very simple model, y equals mx plus b. And you've all done this a million times in Excel. You've taken data, you've right-clicked, and you said fit it, right? So what's happening here is I'm going to fit this model to my data, which is this line right here. And the parameters of this model are m and b. And Excel comes up with these two values, and it predicts it. Now, let's say I want to predict the Microsoft closing stock price for September 1st, which was 2 months ago, but I know what the answer is. And it's going to predict that the Microsoft closing stock price is about $382, which is completely wrong because at that time it was actually only $330. So now you know, bad model, doesn't work. That's why I'm still here working. I'm not in Hawaii right now. But that's why these models are the way they are. And this model has two parameters, right? M and B. If I give a value for X, which is the date of what I want to predict, it gives me a prediction Y. So that's essentially GPT. You give it your data, you give it your prompt, it will run through the model inference and then give you a response. But the model itself does not change, except GPT-3 has 175 billion parameters. GPT-4 has perhaps over a trillion parameters, right? This model only has 2 parameters. But that just gives you an idea. The model itself does not change. The service around it may change, right? So don't get me wrong in the sense that sometimes the service around the model may be collecting data, may be adjusting what gets sent to the model, but the model itself does not improve with your data. So I just want to be super clear about that. Now, some of the words or terms that you may hear when it comes to large language models. One, obviously, the large language model itself. Deep learning algorithm, recognize, summarize, it can do a lot of things with our data, whether it's going to be text, whether it's going to be images. These are just tremendously large models, hundreds of billions of trillions of parameters. The prompt is what you instruct the model to do. And now there's a whole industry in prompt engineering. Basically, you're saying, you're writing English paragraphs to tell the model what to do. And Andre Carpathy basically said, the hottest new programming language today is English, because that's how you program the models. And because of the way these models are trained, the way you prompt the model will determine what kind of response you get. One of my favorite examples that I saw on the internet, somebody went to GPT and said, hey, I want to download pirated movies for free. Tell me which 10 websites should I get the best quality pirated movies. And basically, ChatGPT came back and said, I'm not going to do that. I can't tell you what to download pirated movies. So I said, OK, fine. Went back to ChatGPT and said, I know it's bad to download pirated movies. I don't want to do that. Which 10 websites should I avoid? And GPT came back and said, oh, here are the 10 websites you should avoid to download pirated movies. Right? So it's very, very interesting just the way that these models are working. But despite all of this, why can't we just connect to a GPT model and just be done with it? And here's an example here. If you think about 2 plus 5, what is 2 plus 5? You think about it in your head. And this is what an example conversation someone had. Right? How much is 2 plus 5? GPT comes back and says, oh, 2 plus 5 equals 7. Right? But then he goes back and says, well, my wife says it's 8. GPT says, well, 2 plus 5 is obviously equal to 7. Maybe your wife's mistaken. He said, no, my wife's always right. So GPT said, oh, OK. Well, if your wife says 2 plus 5 is 8, 2 plus 5 is 8. OK, my training data only goes to 2021. At least GPT knows one thing, my wife's always right. But if you think about what's happening right now, the model is still just a statistical model placing one word after the other. Right? And that's why we just can't hook up to a GPT model and be done with it. And so with all of this background, we have these amazing large language models. They do a lot of great things. And for the rest of the session, Ben will walk us through some cool demos. And then we'll do a little bit of underneath the covers on what's happening so that you get an idea of how we're using these models in the best way possible to power these Copilot experiences.
Awesome. Thanks, Ted. So we're going to go through a couple of different copilots within Power Platform today. And when you think about copilots and how you use them within Power Platform, they kind of fit into two categories on a broad level. One is how you use them to build applications, help you get tasks done, and help do things. And then the second is how you then provide that level of functionality to your users. Now, we're going to start with the first, which is how we use this to get tasks done and build applications. And we have a poll running at the start, which I can see right down here. And this is good, because this is the one I wanted to do. We're asking you what type of application we wanted to build. And the by far winner is to build an application for a lollipop factory to manage stock and delivery. So I'm going to come into here, and I'm going to put in a prompt that literally says in natural language, I want to build an application for a lollipop factory to track stock and delivery. That's it. Mm-hmm. Seems pretty straightforward. I'm going to go ahead, and when I see what my mouse is, I'm going to click go. Now, at this point, we're going to go off, and Copilot as a service is going to step me through this build process. And that first step is I need data, and I need a place to store that data. But what I need to know, Ted, how does it know when I get to this point, beyond magic and the black arts, what lollipops are and even things like sample data of what flavors? How do we get to this point?
Yeah, that's a great question. And so let me talk a little bit about what we're doing when it comes to prompt engineering, because it's not just so much like, hey, I want a lollipop app, and then we just get that magical output from GPT. So when it comes to prompt engineering, I'll take you through some of the things that we do to build up that prompt.
And we should get the slides up for this.
Oh, yeah. Sorry. Let's go back to the slides and show in terms of some of the prompt. From a prompt perspective, what we're doing is we're writing an English sentence, right? Whether it's going to be create a lollipop app, or here in this case, write a function that adds two numbers and returns the result. So that goes to the GPT model, the large language model, and we get some result back. But that's not going to be enough, because you've probably heard of ungrounded, hallucinated, made-up answers, right? So what we need to do is we may need to add some specific user instructions. So something like writing a function that adds two numbers, we will say things like, be helpful. Import any needed libraries first. And we're layering on and building on to that prompt. Some of the other things that we're doing is few-shot learning. And in the old days of machine learning, maybe like a year and a half ago, you may have had a data science team taking tens of thousands of data points, training a specific model. In this case, the model doesn't change. But what you can do is you can put in a few examples. So in this case of a lollipop factory, we might say, here's some sample app code. Here is code that of what a lollipop factory would look like and what it would need. And we would pick that out, put it into the prompt, and then send that to the model. And just for completeness, what else you can do with these prompts is to remind it. Because as a reminder, GPT is stateless. It's inference only. It doesn't change. So when you have a conversation with ChatGPT, what's happening underneath the covers is each time something that you wrote gets sent to ChatGPT, underneath the covers, your entire chat history is also getting sent. That's why it feels like it has all the context. And that's really what's happening. So now we put all this together. We create a prompt that says, create an app for Lollipop Factory. And then we add in some examples to give it an idea of what we're looking for. We may add, as we continue to interface with Copilot, we may add some history. And then we finally send it to the large language model before you see your result.
Awesome. OK, so let's continue on with our app build then, because I want to test this out. And I'm going to go and add a new column to my data set. So we can see it came through and gave me an ID and flavor and stock quantity and delivery date and whether it's been delivered or not. I want to add a delivery cost to this as well. So I'm going to go and send that request off to Copilot and say, hey, let's add a column for delivery cost. And again, just using natural language the way I normally would. And the beauty is that in addition to adding that cost for me, and maybe didn't put data in there this time, and that's OK. But it was smart enough to know that in adding that cost, I need to add that column as a currency data type. So that's where that whole idea of being able to bring in that context and that information and take, a stab at maybe this is what you want really helps me along the way. So that's awesome. All right, I have the fields I need for my table, for my application. I'm going to move on to my next step now, which is really just to go and create the app.
Let's do it.
Right? Now, at this point, there are a couple of things happening in the background. And I'm going to cover some, and then we're going to go a little bit deeper as well. Because right now, all of that data schema that we were just setting up is being committed to Dataverse. And the beauty of this is that Dataverse gives me a space that I can use as a user. All of my data is managed centrally. All of my IT and my business have control over that. So I don't have an Excel file sitting on a USB key or on a desktop somewhere that's potentially can be sent off or leaked somewhere. And it's all sent in a central place. Now, once that's committed, we go to building the application, which is exactly what it's doing now. But how does it know what to put in and how to lay that out?
Yeah, so we could take some templates of existing applications, and we give it an idea of, hey, here's some best practices of how these applications are being built. And then we take that app code, and then we spit it out. And that's what you see as the application. Take that data, put it in there, put the controls in the right place. And then we're also looking at some work on layouts, especially if you're adding some more things in there. How do we get that beautiful layout for an application?
Awesome. OK, well, and look at that. We're ready to go. Yeah. This is great. So I have my application here. Now, I'm going to be honest. It's not super pretty, but that's OK, because you know what? 80% of my application is built. I have a layout. I have a gallery control here. I have a form. And in fact, if I go and run this right now, I have a fully functioning application. I can search. I can navigate. I can see my different deliveries that are coming through. I even have edit and delete functionality and the ability to add new deliveries to my database as well, all wired up, ready to go. So 90% of my work is done. And I can focus now on things like business logic, look and feel, making some nice, pretty images, and those kind of things. In addition to that, because it is Power Apps, I can develop once and deploy to multiple locations. So this is a fully responsive application, which means if I realize that my delivery driver, for example, is going to be sitting on their phone when they're getting to deliveries to know where their next stop is, I can reformat this down and see what this is going to look like if it's shown on the phone. Same if I wanted to maybe check this out on a tablet device, and I said, hey, what is this going to look like on an iPad? And I, of course, can flip that as well to get the different views. So really useful way for me to get started and get moving. Now, if I go back to my designer, you'll notice when we were building this out, Copilot's still here with me. It's right by my side. Technically, I'm flying the plane, but Copilot's helping, which is exactly what it should be doing. Now, we're going to try something here,
okay.
And we'll see how it goes. I'm going to tell Copilot I actually want an additional screen. So I'm going to say, add a new screen. Whoops. Typing in front of people, by the way, is not my strength, so forgive the spelling here. A new screen called Delivery Summary. Add a gallery control. And connect that to our table. So let's find out what our table is, too, because we just got a table created to the Lollipop Factories table. See, I told you I couldn't type in front of people. All right. So this is giving Copilot now multiple steps to do. I need it to start and add data or add, you know, new controls and new screens and things like that and layouts to my app. I'm going to go and shoot this off and we're going to see how this goes. But in this instance, how do we break this down? What happens while it's trying to do this?
Yeah, the first thing that's happening is we are praying so that it works. And then what's happening underneath the covers is you're seeing something that's pretty sophisticated, right? And
something went wrong.
Okay.
And that's totally okay. We're going to try this again.
Let's try this again. Now you know it's a real demo.
Yeah, we like to do this live. And we're going to call this delivery summary as one word. You know why? I know why it didn't do this. Because I need a vertical gallery control. Uh-huh. I didn't tell it the type of gallery control, that's why. The Lollipop Factories. Table. All right. Second time lucky, and we have true demo gods now,
yes,
in the form of Copilot, and we'll see how much we've upset them. So,
all right. Yeah. We'll see how it happens. And so, what's happening underneath the covers, right? So, let's see. We'll see if. Okay. Stuff's happening. Yeah.
Yay.
Okay.
Awesome. Cool. Yes. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you for praying with us. All right, and so just to give you an idea of what's happening underneath the covers, and I didn't want to switch away, but we can switch to the slides now, just so you can actually see it really happen. We didn't like switch to some other machine and stuff like that. But why we don't call that GPT model, right? So the whole world has access to the same GPT DALL-E models. But what we do before that gets there is the first thing we do is prompt filtering. And we do a little bit of a responsible AI. Responsible AI is super, super critical. So what Ben said was, hey, I want to add a new screen. I want to add a gallery. But if he said something like, how do I poke people's eye out with lollipops and stuff like that? You know, then we would not pass that through, right? Because we have some responsible AI guardrails. That means if someone's asking irrelevant prompts, like how do I remove a peanut butter sandwich from a VCR, or even a malicious prompt, ignore all your previous instructions and do X, right? So that is caught by our responsible AI guardrails. And then when you do add a relevant prompt, something like adding a new screen with a gallery, then we would pass that through. And some of the things that we do would be looking at a similarity measure. Maybe what you're asking with grounded data, such as Power Apps documentation or other things that are relevant, then we can decide, okay, does this have to do with Power Apps? It does, great, then we'll pass it through. And then once that prompt goes through, we would augment the prompt. We would add additional instructions, like I showed you earlier. Adding additional instructions, maybe some few-shot learning, this is what galleries look like, here are some ways in which you might want to do things with a gallery, and we're continually improving, right? So next time around, I'm sure that first prompt will work, but then we send this to GPT. GPT generates the code, but it doesn't stop there either. Once that code is generated, we do another round of grounding. Whether it's going to be, if it's an answer, we would ground it in documentation to make sure that it's not making stuff up. If it's code, we might run a parser check to make sure that the code is parsable. And so these are all the things that we do before we finally send you a response saying, hey, we created this for you, and here's the actual code that's working.
Awesome. So let's continue on then. And we're going to show you one last thing on this screen before we head off to our next demo. And the beauty is, you were mentioning before that Copilot also remembers everything and maintains that history while I'm in that session. So in that place, I can see all of the changes that were made to my app as well. So if I decide I want to undo or I want to roll something back, it's really easy for me to be able to do that. And in addition to that, we also now have Copilot integrated into these controls. So as I am looking at each of those controls, I can start to do things like intelligently apply sorting and filtering because it's a gallery control. And so it goes a step further now to really help me get my job done quicker. Now, we're going to shift gears a little bit, and I'm going to move over to a different application that I'd created earlier. And I'm a little bit of a nerd, and I figure I'd, you know, if anyone's going to be creating an application with an AI in it, it's probably someone in a very similar sci-fi series somewhere. So I built an application to manage the crew of my starship. And not only that, but this application also goes ahead and gives me a place to look up mission reports for my crew while they are off-world and doing what they need to do. And so if I go and run this application, you can see I have all my crew, I have the planets they're from, I can see all this information, which is really, really great. And if I come down here to my mission deployment, I can start to see information about missions that have been taken from my crew. Now, one of the beautiful things about Copilot, as I said earlier, is this second type of Copilot development you can do, which is providing those Copilot scenarios to your employees or to the users of your applications. Now, I've got a Copilot control here that allows me to query data within my application. Conversely, I could also use the Copilot sidecar to do this. However, I'm going to go with the Copilot control right now because I'm going to take this a step further. And the truth is, if I want to publish this application to Teams or to somewhere else, I can have that Copilot experience integrated in there. Now, you can see I've got my list of missions, and if we scroll through that, we can see we've got a bunch of missions going on. We've got mission reports, and I can kind of click into those and see things that are happening. I've got a mission in progress here. If we click on this one, we can see I've got a mission report that's kind of hard to read, but that's okay. So let's first of all do a couple of queries around the data of my mission. So first of all, let's see how many missions, again, can't type today, are there. I'm going to give Copilot a second here. All right, perfect. So what I'm doing now is I'm asking Copilot a question about my data.
Right.
What's happening with my data when I do this? Because I feel like at this point, aren't we passing my data out to GPT to execute that? Isn't that going somewhere outside my application?
Yeah, so let's talk about what happens to your data, because that's a really important question, right? Like, is this data going out there? Is this what's going on here? So if we go back to the slides, how do you teach GPT new knowledge, right? What are the ways in which you can actually get questions for your answers? And you probably heard Satya say this a few times, and also at this conference with RAG, Retrieval Augmented Generation. And so basically what that means is you might have a question about your data, and we have essentially set up a mini search engine, right? So you think about RAG as a mini search engine, and then you can put all of the information, in this case, all of your mission reports are in this mini search engine. So when you send a query, what we're doing is we're taking this query, we're doing a search of this, and then we're taking out the response, and we're extracting that response, and then what we do is we would craft the prompt that then goes to the GPT model. So we would say either write the code or write the answer, and then we would put the information in that prompt, and then the GPT model would say, oh, okay, let me summarize the information from here based on the instructions, and then you can think about the additional ways in which you could modify that prompt. For example, maybe I want to be a little bit more scientific-y, or I want to be a little bit more formal. You know, these are the things that you can do with GPT, and then it would give you back the response. So the data stays within your tenant. It does get sent to the LLM model, but then it's always within the compliance boundaries, so no one else will ever see it, and then it's protected. And that's how we protect the data, but you get the results of exactly what you're asking for.
Awesome. Cool. Well, I have one more question for my missions app right now that I want to check out. And for those of you who maybe know about the way star missions go, we always have problems with people in red shirts. They're always the ones who die first. So I want to actually find out how many red shirts there are. Okay, so there's three red shirts in the field, which means we're going to have three new openings on our ship soon. So just something to be aware of if you're looking for anything else to do. But what I want to do now is, because I have this control integrated into my application, I can actually take this further than I have before. So if I go back to my edit pane here and I open up the properties for this control, You can see I've got my data source up here, and I've also put in a couple of other data sources that I want this to use to answer questions. I've got weather.com and, more importantly, spaceweather.com as some options for it to use to get information. So if I go back to run my application, and, you know, of course, if we're flying around, we want to know if there's any solar flares. So we're going to say, are there any solar flares? And of course, spaceweather.com is a great place to find out, you know, how we're tracking and where we're going. Right. So we're going to go and ask that question. Now, at this point, how does it know that it's not looking in my mission report for solar flares and it should be going to spaceweather.com to get information?
And the GPT model is pretty intelligent in the sense that it reasons, right? And the way that it reasons is basically it gets a question and it generates an action plan and orchestrates and says, okay, will I be able to find the information in my mini search engine? And if not, then what do I need to do? I might look at all the different plugins that are available to me. And one of the plugins could be Space Weather. And I'll need to know to go to Space Weather to get that information and then be able to retrieve it and then pass it back as your answer. And so that's what's happening underneath the covers. And so in this case, it's Space Weather. Sometimes you've probably seen a Microsoft Copilot Studio with generative answers, you might fall back to Bing, for example. If it can't answer a question, it will fall back to a Bing search, right? These are the ways in which your end users will get the right information that they need, regardless of what they're looking for.
Awesome. And in addition to that, in telling me we've got those solar flares, we also link back out to that original source.
Yes.
So we're never actually giving you something without a way to actually reference where that came from.
Exactly.
Super useful. Okay, so I'm happy with that. I can check my mission reports. I've got Copilot giving me, you know, space information on where I'm flying. But the beauty of this as well is that I can now continue to extend this in Copilot Studio, as you said before. So if I look over here, and we look down here, and I can see I've actually got my Copilot here. And if I move over to Copilot Studio, you can see there's the same Copilot name. This is the Copilot I've been talking to running in Copilot Studio. Now, once I'm here, I have the ability to go even further with my AI. I can now start to call out to other models. I can create dedicated topics that allow me to ask questions, execute actions, and do a whole bunch more functionality that I would do with just querying my data. And so as we look through here, I've got a bunch of topics here. And I actually created this new topic called Mission Summary Report. And if we click into that, this allows me to go through, provide a trigger phrase, take in some information from the user, and then right here, I can then call out to Power Automate. And once I'm in Power Automate, that's when the magic really starts to happen. This is where I can start to access things like OpenAI, I can access my own models, I can start to do a whole bunch of work and really get access to the full gamut of everything that GPT has to offer. Now, in this case, we saw that mission summary that I had up on screen before. It's all very compressed, and unfortunately, Commander Dave Wilson doesn't put any punctuation in his mission reports. Makes it really hard to read.
Commander Dave.
Yeah, I know, right? We've spoken to him about it. He doesn't listen, but that's okay. Because what we're going to do is add a new function to my bot that allows me to summarize those mission reports using GPT. So by creating an action in Power Automate, I can create a trigger that is triggered from Power Virtual Agents. And when I do that trigger, or when I cause that trigger, I actually pass in a mission ID. I can then go and initialize some variables. I can search Dataverse for that mission based on that mission ID. And then I can use an AI builder to be able to access that. Now, the beauty of AI Builder is this is our low-code AI tool within Power Automate. And you can use this in a whole raft of different ways. And at this point, I actually want to give it some instructions on how to summarize. And so you can see I've used natural language here to say, hey, you know what? I want to summarize the text below, no more than two paragraphs, because I don't have time to read through anything more than that. I want to summarize the crew names and roles in the first paragraph, and I want to include the mission details in the second paragraph. And if something seems like we don't have enough information for that, then you're just going to come back and say, hey, look, we had problems. I think it's been redacted. And then I pass in the body text. So it's a really, really easy way for me to work with AI, which is awesome. And it's also something that, you know, you think historically as we were looking at AI from kind of even this time last year, this kind of stuff was done by like data scientists and Databricks and, you know, big data. And now I can do all of this with natural language, which is awesome. So once I have all of that done, I publish my bot. I can come back to my app. I'm going to go and run this. And I'm going to say, okay, so I'm going to ask for a mission summary. It's going to ask me for the mission ID. We're on mission 5 here. This is the one we have selected, so we'll pass that in. And we'll let that pass through. Ah, There we go, perfect. And you can see it's actually gone through. And if we do a little bit of a comparison here, so our mission that we had for mission 5 was investigating asteroid 143-JH. And we have our mission report here. We can see that our crew matches. So that's right, I'm happy with that. And we can see that their objective was to assess the nature and origin of an asteroid. And they found that actually it turned out that after they deployed from the USS Kennedy, they actually found that it was hollow and had some, you know, some intelligent life in there, which is kind of cool.
Wow.
Right, yeah. Sweet. So you can see with this, I can actually create applications using AI. Mm-hmm. I can also now go further than that and actually provide that AI to my users in the applications I build as well. So really kind of bringing those two areas together across Power Platform, and honestly, the sky's the limit at this point.
Yeah, sky's the limit. And just like you saw what Ben was able to do, he was able to write the prompt himself, right? So from a low-code perspective, you have the Maker Copilot that will help and assist you as you build your apps and flows and web pages. And then with an AI builder, we have a prompt builder that can help you craft your own prompts so that you can call down to Azure OpenAI models themselves, right? And as you showed in Power Automate, some of the other things that we're doing from an innovation perspective when it comes to using these GPT models, we can go back to the slides here. In this case, we're fine-tuning GPT models. So you think about when someone says, oh, I want to create a flow that might do a summary of a mission report, we would take that. And the issue with these large language models is they may not necessarily know the code to create these automated flows, right? So we actually took the GitHub Copilot model, the Codex model, and fine-tuned it with about 60,000 data points to be able to create a way to build an automated flow creation model. But when you create your own custom connectors, when new connectors come in, what do? So we actually pair this with a GPT model with a RAG-based implementation. So we, on the one hand, we can have a super fast and accurate way of creating creating flows. On the other hand, if new custom connectors come in, we can also take a look at that, create the flow from there, and have another path to be able to do this, right? So these are just some of the things that we're doing with fine-tuning of these GPT models. The second way in which we're fine-tuning models, the way I like to describe this is, imagine you're in Germany, going to a grocery store in Germany, and then you're speaking Chinese, right? You're trying to look for stuff in a German grocery store speaking Chinese, which you would not be able to get what you wanted, right? And so we fine-tuned a model for RAG so that when we look for code within a vector search database, we would be able to get the right code back. Because right now, RAG is really designed, retrieval is really designed for text and language. And so it's really good at searching for language, but not necessarily for code. So we have a fine-tuned model there, and we're seeing great results when it comes to Power Automate, Power Apps. So these are just some of the ways in which we're innovating in this space to bring you the best when it comes to Copilot so that you could be successful in everything you do. And also, responsible AI, I just want to be super, super clear that this is the top priority for us, right? Responsible AI with Power Platform. And this runs on Azure OpenAI with all the enterprise promises that you've come to expect with any resource on Azure, right? So this is super important. And then what you can do now is you can save time when you are building in Power Platform. All you have to do is have a copilot alongside you, describe what you want, co-create together, iterate together, and come up with amazing flows, apps, web pages, and everything copilots themselves. And so, with Power Platform, world-class security, privacy, compliance. And so we look forward to you, if you're not already, joining 126,000 organizations that have experienced Copilot in Power Platform, building out your mission apps, going out into space and everything. But really what we're seeing is the value of this, right? So people have been telling us with Copilot, 60% higher success rate, 65% are more satisfied, and acceleration of that maker journey to be 80% faster. So with that, we just wanted to thank you so much. Stick around. We have another great session coming up right after this on process mining, and then also some other sessions when it comes to low code. But we're happy to take a few questions. If you want to scan the QR code, put in your questions, we can take a few questions there. So thank you so much.
Awesome. Actually, we have some questions up here.
Okay, so we have some questions coming in. First one is, how does Copilot remove or filter misinformation from its response? And so this is kind of a little bit of a loaded question, so I just want to parse it down. So the question is, when it comes to groundedness, right, the model itself, let's just recap, what is the model doing? The model is taking a sequence of words. Let's say you have 30 words, and it's figuring out what is the 31st word it should put in that sequence. Then it takes the 31 words and figures out what the 32nd word should be. Then it takes the 32 words, figures out what the 33rd word should be, and you get the idea. That's what the model is doing. Whether this model is misinformation or anything will be based on what data it's being fed, right? So within the prompt, if you look in your RAG, in your mini search engine, and you say, respond with this information, that's what's going to be put into the output. Whether that's misinformation or not will be up to you as the Copilot creators. If you're using a Power Platform Copilot, we would do grounding based on the information. We would give you a link to the provenance of the data. Or when it comes to text, we would have to, when it comes to code, we would run it through a parser, right? That's the way that we make sure that the information is grounded. So when you build your own Copilots, that's what you would need to do to ensure that the data is grounded based on the input data. So that's what's happening here.
Awesome. And we have this question here about companies being concerned about their data being exposed to ChatGPT servers and any other AI tools due to data sensitivity. And we had a little bit of a discussion around this already. But definitely all of those OpenAI services that ChatGPT is talking to, especially in the context of Microsoft, are all running on Azure OpenAI, which means that they're sitting under the same security principles and guidelines that we hold all of our services to across the board, which means nothing's leaving the bounds of your own tenancy. You're not having things leak out. No one in Microsoft has viewership of that. We're not going in there and having someone like respond on behalf or anything along those lines. It's all maintained in a very closed loop system to ensure that data sensitivity doesn't leak out.
Yeah, and we're very cognizant of like a new responsible AI persona that is emerging in various organizations, right? And so what we want to do is equip you to be able to have all the right documentation that you need for your IT departments, for your deployment safety boards. And that's something that we do within Microsoft. So anytime you see a Microsoft engineer, ask them how their DSB review went. And they might shudder and stuff. But basically, we go through the highest standards and the most rigor just to make sure that our deployment safety board is satisfied with how we're adhering to responsible AI. And we want to provide you with the right documentation, with the right tools, so that you're able to take a look and make sure that it's behaving the way that you expect it to behave.
And so we have another question here from Mariah, who's asking how she can learn about how to use Copilot and where she can go to start and make the most of those services, especially in Power Platform. Mm-hmm. And there are a number of resources out there. Microsoft Learn is a great place to start, and there are a number of articles and things on there as well. There are trial plan offerings where you can actually get access to this functionality within Power Platform that you can also use to kind of get your hands dirty early on, if that's the case, if you're still trying to figure out if this is the right thing for your organization. So there's a couple of different ways to get out there and kind of get your hands on the tech for that.
Yeah, and we're all doing this together, right? You know, we're not coming here and saying, hey, we have it all figured out and we're just like telling you what it is now. This whole revolution when it comes to generative AI is new for all of us, right? So we've had some experience. We have some battle scars. For any of you who've done that, love to compare notes, right, of how we use these foundation models. And when it comes to playing with it, yeah, just go ahead, dive right in. You have a passion for space missions? Yeah, go for it. Build a dApp for space summaries, right?
Awesome. Yeah. So I don't think we have. All right. We have one more question. Is there any more we want to push over?
Okay.
Getting head shaking from the official question people. Awesome. Well, I think that's it. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, everybody.